title, the subtitle of this is Why Pura? If you're very familiar with your Old Testament Bible stories, Pura was the armor bearer, the servant, the armor bearer of Gideon, and which I will get to it. I think through the years, I have thought for years and years, one of the funniest stories in the Bible is the story of Gideon and Pura. And who does Pura represent and what does he represent? My intention is that this message will benefit you whether you've never been here before and will never be here again. I believe you will hear realities that can help you for the rest of your life. Or whether you have been here for years and years and you intend to be here next week, you will hear realities that I think will benefit your life. Whether you're a part of or aware of our changing congregation dynamics. I had someone say to me recently, if you asked a group of people, every individual in a group of people, who do you obey or who do you consider to be an authority over your life? They said they have found in their lives that it depends on the age of the individual that you ask. If you ask someone who is, I'll say, more our age, you know, we fall into the category of people who are older than 40, not everyone in the room for sure, we will tend to say, well, God, and we may say the government, and if you're having your employer on your mind and you're thinking very employeristically, Faye will tell me afterwards that's not a word, that you may say your employer. If you ask someone who's younger, maybe a teenager, and maybe someone in their early 20s, the tendency, the answer you will tend to hear is nobody. Nobody has authority over me. I don't think they would use the word supreme, but it's what they mean. I have supreme authority over my life. I have the final say. If you study Scripture, and you begin at the beginning, where if you read books, and you would be like me, if you were like me, is I got to see how it starts. I need to know what's on the very first page or the first few seconds of a movie, because sometimes so much is revealed in those first few seconds. I've got to know that. Well, the Bible makes it crystal clear we are here because of a creator who has created us. Our world is here not because of evolutionary process. Our world is here because of a creator, a designer. It's as likely that this world sprung into existence, this is not my analogy, as a Coke can appeared on a beach someday, printed and full of Coke, and it arrived all by itself without any human hands. There was no people, no manufacturing, nothing. It just, pop, it just came into existence. Or maybe it came into existence through a long series of pre-cans, pre-liquid that eventually became Coca-Cola, eventually aluminum came into being maybe after a long time, and then eventually aluminum and then paint came into being on its own, kind of, just sort of. Enough time went by, and then a can popped up with a pop-top lid, and it took millions and millions of years, but with enough time, anything can happen, which is not true. The likelihood of all of this just coming into being on its own through a non-directed process is, the Bible calls it foolish. Just fool. The fool has said that. There is no God. What is his intention? What does he really want? If you chronologically take chapter 1, 2, and 3, he wants you to understand everything he brought into being, and his intentions were good. He created it. The scripture says it was good. Mankind, it was very good. Yes, the dimension of authority is certainly covered in the second chapter of the Bible, where God created man, created companionship for him, gave him significance, gave him responsibility, gave him jobs, gave him boundaries. Everything here is yours. You can eat it, except there's two trees in the middle of it. One of them you can just lavish yourself on. Other ones stay away from. Don't eat of that tree. So he created boundaries. Significance, meaningful occupation, name all the animals in existence. That was a pretty significant job. We may have a conversation with Adam in heaven when giraffe. How did you pick the name giraffe for that animal? Well, I'll tell you, it came about this way. I'm looking forward to hearing some of his explanations of where those names came from. It's in chapter 3 that you find the real heart of God, and that is, he did this, I think, because of his love for us, his desire that we live meaningful lives with realistic, healthy boundaries. But the real reason he did it, because he wanted to walk with us in the cool of the evening. He wanted fellowship with us. He wanted exchange between him and us. He wanted to be with us. He wanted, yes, I believe as a father, he wanted us to be with him. But the real intent was he wanted to kind of just walk in the beauty of the garden and just enjoy it together. It was a great idea when you thought of irises. Those are such beautiful flowers. And he dialogues with us. That's the real intent of God. So I hope that your thoughts of God don't stop in Genesis chapter 2, where God said there's two trees, one you eat, one you don't eat. I hope that your thoughts of God don't stop with, he's the one who sets the rules and Katie bar the door if you violate those rules. That's so unfortunate if that's how you are living your life and that's how you view God, because he really wants to walk and talk with you. He wants to share life with you. He wanted us to be alive with him forever, so that's why Jesus came. That comes out to me in this story. Why Pura? Gideon. So Romans 12:12. This was given to us supernaturally out on our website or out on YouTube. If you type in, when you search on YouTube, type NCF. Media, NCF Media, our insignia will come up. If you click on that, then there's dozens and dozens and dozens of messages. It's very simple to find at the moment. They'll eventually be linked to our website. In the earlier messages of this, Roman, this is the fourth one, I explain how God supernaturally gave to this congregation this particular verse. And I believe it was for such a time as then, and it's for such a time as now. What is it that God is hoping has expressed and has specifically pointed us out? Because he wants us to remember, you rejoice in hope, you be patient, you stay steadfast, patient in pressure, trouble, tribulation, and stay at it, just be steadfast, consistent in prayer. Those three things. You've got to have hope. You've got to have patience as you deal with the pressure that you're going to deal with. And above all, keep it very God-centered, God-focused, God-dependent, and steadfast in prayer. He gave that to us very, very supernaturally. And I'm focusing on what is giving me hope. Rejoice in hope. Those are things you have to believe. The scriptures are what have given me hope. So I've been trying to teach on two major rhythms in scripture, or patterns, or revelations, or the ways of God that they're revealed in scripture. So the same God that created life and spoke to men to write the scriptures to explain to us who he is, what he was doing, what his intentions were, where they're leading to, is the same God who still is speaking today. He's speaking to you and to me. He doesn't ever violate what he has given to us as a standard to compare against, but he's actively speaking to you and me in our lives. The Bible is full of stories of God speaking to people. I believe it is not just to establish a record. That's how God did it. When he was doing it, that's how he did it. I think the purpose of it is, this is how God does things. He has given us an infallible record so we can have a standard to come against and look against for our lives and to understand. But it's intended to say, if you want to understand God, this is the way he does things. Or you could have a very static view of God. This is the way he did things. He's all done doing things. And he wants us to, he's just sitting back, relaxing, because he's done all that he's going to do. And it's ours to try and understand and come to appreciation of what he's done. I believe we should have full appreciation for what he's done, but I also believe the scriptures tell us how God does things to give us insight on how we live our lives. So the major cycle that begins in chapter 1 and goes to the end of the Bible is the birth, the death, and God's provision, or the supernatural fulfillment. It's because of sin that has come into life. God began it. Sin came in. It messed everything up. Through the provision of Jesus Christ, God restored to us what's possible. In the end, we'll live with him in heaven, which will be sinless, and we'll have no more of those marks. And so many of the stories of the Bible, you see that pattern. God births vision, births calling. It seems to die naturally or be impossible for it to come to pass. And through God's provision, because life depends on him. He is the author of life. He didn't design life for us to live independent lives, but to be totally dependent upon someone who loves us, who is for us, who's supported, who wants relationship. The second that we've looked at is God's choices are not our choices. God's thoughts are not our thoughts. The way God chooses, who God chooses. So we've spent time on that. Today I want to look at a third one. God will offend the mind to address our hearts. In Scripture, there's enough stories that about the best way I've heard someone else phrase it, God will purposefully, deliberately offend your mind to reveal your heart, to address your heart, to speak to your heart, so you would come to understand the nature of your heart. He certainly did that to me when I first went to Toronto. I walked in the door and stood in the room. Most of you know the story. There was a young man, I'm revealing my age, my generation. There was a young man on the platform playing guitar and had a baseball cap on. I wasn't raised in those kinds of circles. We didn't wear hats in our house. Certainly at church, people didn't wear hats, guys didn't wear hats, much less on the platform. If they were playing in the band or the worship, someone, they didn't wear baseball caps. So I realize if you're raised in this generation, well, you know, it's almost like you're naked if you don't have a cap on and you're a guy. I do understand that. But so I walked in with my culture and my values into the room, big room, I mean, 40 times the size of this room, 100 times the size of the big, big, big room. And there was a young man on the platform wearing a baseball cap. I think God did that specifically for me. He wanted to offend my heart. I actually did, stood there thinking, am I going to go in? Am I going to stay? I flew up there to spend a week there. Am I going to stay? There's a kid on the platform, I'm showing you where I was, sad, with a baseball cap on. I chose to stay. And then over the course of a week, I saw so many things take place with an outpouring of the Holy Spirit. I saw so many things that God was able to reveal the pride and arrogance of my own heart, because I heard myself saying the things that I am seeing have to be wrong because I have never seen them before. That's what makes them wrong. In my own personal experience, I've not seen them, and I was actually thinking those kinds of thoughts. They're wrong because I've never seen it before. And eventually I woke up and realized, that's me speaking. How arrogant is that? God will offend the mind to address our heart. I believe one of the classic Bible stories is Gideon. God offended his mind to show him where his heart was, because he wanted to address it. He wanted to fix it, meaning God wanted to correct what was such a limitation in his heart. Not because God was mad at him that you actually have this in your heart. No, this is limiting you. This is keeping you from accomplishing what I've really designed for you, which is phenomenal for you to experience. But that's hurting you. So I want to address it. I want to remove it. Not because I'm so hacked off that this is on the inside of you. So I'm in Judges chapter 7 in the Gideon story. It begins actually in chapter 6. Chapter 6, verse 16. You miss this and the earlier verses where God said, I was the one who led you, Israel, out of Egypt. I was the one who delivered you. I was the one who brought you into the land. Because he wanted them to know, I am for you. I am good. I am the one who has destiny for you. I have picked it. It is good. But you have gone and given yourself to other gods, thinking these other gods are the answers for my life. When God was saying, I'm the answer. Don't you have such a track record that you don't hold on to that? There's a second thought that God wanted us, Gideon, practical. It's not just a Bible story to be understood as, yeah, I know the story of Gideon and I know what happened. But what was God teaching him? What is he teaching to us? And he's saying, this is how I do things. So chapter 6, verse 16, and the Lord said to him, God sent an angel to say, hey, I've got something for you. I'm going to use you to deliver this nation. And the Lord said to him, surely I will be with you, and you shall defeat the Midianites, just as if there was 130,000 of them, 135,000. And he said, just like there's only one of them, that's what it's going to be like, because I'm going to be with you. It is that point is the point. The two things that God is trying to impart to Gideon, to us. I am God. I have created you. My intentions for you are good. I will be with you. That's how you're going to do it. It's because I'm going to be with you. That's my promise. Where do we get in trouble? I'll do it myself. I can take care of me. I will do it on my own. Surely I will be with you. So in the beginning of the story is the angel of God speaking, communicating what God the Father was saying to Gideon at that time period. Some people think that may have been Jesus pre-incarnate. It could have been. It was God speaking. So Judges chapter 7, verse 2, jumping into 7. The Lord's heart, we covered this last week, so I'm just jumping to chapter 7, verse 2. And the Lord said to Gideon, the people who are with you are too many for me to give the Midianites into their hands. It's because of sin, pride. Because of sin, arrogance. Because of sin, we can do it on our own. I don't need anybody over me, watching out for me, giving me guidance of how I should go. I'm a big boy, I'm a big girl, I can do this all by myself. The people who are with you, so in this Bible story that actually did take place, but God's using it to reveal himself to us, as well as to let us know, okay, this is what I did in this instance. Pay attention, I may do the same thing in your life. The people who are with you are too many for me to give the Midianites into their hands. Why? Lest Israel claim glory for itself against me, saying, my own hand has saved me. My own pulling myself up by my bootstraps. That's why, how I've gotten to where I am. It was me who saved me. And God wants to say, it's not designed that way. Yeah, but I personally am... I'm better off believing there's no God, there's no one I'm accountable to, there's no one who actually has designed destiny for me and wants relationship with me and wants to, in essence, walk with me through life, encouraging me, helping me, causing exhilaration. I'm better off thinking there is no God and all this just poofed into existence. Because he doesn't want... Lest Israel claim glory for itself against me, saying, my own hand has saved me. Bottom line, it's going to depend on me. What God is trying to say is, bottom line, it was all designed for us to depend upon him. Not because he might get mad. It's the way it was designed. Why put gas in a car? It was designed for gas. That's how it runs good. Judges 7, verse 8. He sent away all the rest of Israel, every man to his tent, and retained those 300 men. So I've jumped through the two things that we covered last week. Now, he went from 32,000 to 300. The 32,000 were never really good enough because it was 135,000 they were going against. But you could say it was roughly 4 to 1 or 5 to 1. Now it changed to 450 to 1. Those aren't good odds. He sent away all the rest of Israel, every man to his tent, and he retained those 300 men. Now the camp of Midian was below him in the valley. So they're kind of up on ridges or up on the mountaintops, kind of, so to speak. And the enemy... down there, big enemy down there, is that's where they are. And so they have a chance to at some level, possibly overlook and see how big the opposition is. When there's 32,000 of you, if they were able to do that, you know, well, you know, it's 4 or 5 to 1. We might be able to pull this off. But when it's 450 enemy for each individual soldier, it's like, what God wants us to learn is that he's with us. He'll give the situation into your hands. It's because of his involvement, not because of what we can pull off with our own abilities. You live life that way, you live way below what God has intended for you and for me. It happened, verse 9, on the same night. So here it is, they're down to the 300. And on the same night, the Lord said to him, okay, get up, arise. He didn't say sleepyhead, I'll say sleepyhead, arise. Go down against the camp, for I have delivered them into your hand. That's what he wants us to live in the light of, the recognition of. Not this story just so we say, wow, that's kind of a cool story. Wasn't that wonderful what God did back then? What God wants is, this is what God wants to do now in our lives. And what are we using as the authority of that? His word, because it reveals his way and the way he's done things. So God says, okay, it's time. Now go down there. Verse 10. I think this is the funniest verse in the whole Bible. But if you are afraid to go down, I got a remedy for you. If you read this from enough translations, I've read it from many. If you're afraid to go down, if you're afraid to take the 300 and go after the 135,000, if that causes fear in your heart to take what I've given you and go against what you have been sent to take on head to head, said, I have a remedy for you. Go down to the camp with Pura, your servant. I know the child is saying, I can't believe it. That's impossible. God would say something like that. Well, he did. So here was God's remedy. If you're afraid to go down there with the 300 that I've provided for you, then just go down there with one more. Right, that's going to take care of it. So the odds jump from 450 to 1 to what's half, 135,000, roughly 70, maybe 65, 70,000 to 1. Right, the odds change. All I got to take on is close to 70,000 men by myself. Pura, he'll take the other 70,000. I just think God will offend your mind because he wants to show you what's in your heart that's hindering you, that's keeping you from just saying, yes, Lord, I'm yours. What you want me to do? God wasn't mad at him. He wasn't punishing. He was just like, okay, you're too afraid to take 300, so you go and just take your armor bearer, take Pura, your servant. I just think that's such a hilarious. That's like the day of Pentecost, and God pours out the long-awaited Holy Spirit. Thousands of years have gone by since the fall in the garden, and Jesus had come and risen from the dead, and he had ascended on high, and his blood was accepted on high, and the Father gives him a present, and the present is the Holy Spirit, and Jesus pours the present out. Acts chapter 2 tells us this. But what did it look like on that day? They looked like 120 drunken men and women. That was the Holy Spirit? And they were speaking. Everybody understood what they were saying in their own language. That was humility personified. That was God at his best. And still to this day, if you talk about the baptism of the Holy Spirit, tongues, you're talking about tongues. I am not going to say out of my mouth what I don't know what it is. Okay, so you want total control. I will not let words out of my mouth that I don't know exactly what those words mean. So you want to control. You want total control. You're going to have a hard time with obeying God if you want total control. But I'll sound foolish. Okay, so it's pride. You're afraid what you're going to look like. Well, maybe it might be a demon speaking through me. Well, Jesus made it clear, if you ask for an egg, you'll get an egg. God won't give you a rock if you ask for the Holy Spirit. Yeah, but, the butt machine. That's our excuses. It's called the excuse machine. What happened on the day of Pentecost? God was offending the mind. He still is offending the mind to this day to reveal the heart. So here's my suggestion. You're afraid to go down with the 300, go down with one. Right. And you shall hear what they say, and afterward your hand shall be strengthened to go down against the camp. So God said, if you'll do that, if you'll do what I'm telling you to do, you're going to hear some things, and they're actually going to cause you to be stronger. If you do what I'm telling you to do, you may not think this is the way for me to get stronger, is to go down there with just one other person. Absolutely, I'm going to get stronger. No, it's what he saw God working down there. He saw the movement of God. It wasn't him. The point was not to be, oh, I now, I understand now, I got it now, it makes sense to me now, I can see how I can do this, I can. No, the point was, God, you had me do that so I would hear this, so I would see there's no way that could have happened by luck or circumstance. That was the planning of Almighty God. My goodness, he wanted me to see his hand is fully involved. And that will help me rise above what I think about of myself or my own abilities. And you shall hear what they say. And afterward, your hands shall be strengthened to go down against the camp. Because you're going to come to the reality, the realization, it's not circumstances. It's not how fortunate it was, or fortuitous. What a coincidence that happened just at that time, that happened. Then he went down with Pura, his servant, to the outpost of the armed men who were in the camp. So I'm under the impression it was kind of the outskirt where an outpost was. And they got close enough, they had to get close enough to hear. So it's two. Now, the Midianites and the Amalekites and all the people of the east were lying in the valley as numerous as locusts, and their camels were without number as the sand is by the seashore in multitude. God's doing that to picture what was being dealt with today, but he's hoping that we'll kind of understand. We may feel, there are so many, there's so much money that I owe, there are so many people who are missing in this instance, everybody's gone, they're all gone. What in the world are we going to do because everybody's gone? If God wants you to still be there, no, everybody's not gone. Everybody who maybe were supposed to be gone is gone. You mean God wanted to use me? He wanted to depend on me? He wants you to be involved in what he's doing. And their camels are without number as the sand by the seashore in multitude. So, you know, the opposition, the enemy, the problem, you could say. And when Gideon had come, there was a man. So here he is. There's 135,000 of them. They'll occupy a big area. So how many outposts were there? We don't know. Could it have been just one? That's possible. A group that big, I doubt it, but we don't know. It's only conjecture. So they're sneaking down. They have to pick the right outpost. They have to make it past whoever they had to make it past to get close enough that they come to the outpost. And And when Gideon, and timing, they have to get there at the right time, you understand, while they're having this conversation. Do you think that God is can direct even the exact moment a conversation takes place, or you hear someone say something, or on the radio there's a song and you have me writing and you hear that song right at that moment? Yeah, that's what this story teaches you. God does that. He'll wait till you arrive on the scene because he's doing something in your life. And then he'll have the disc jockey think, I think I'll play this song. And, I was going to play it a half hour ago, but I forgot about it. I remember, so they play the song. And you're riding in your car, and you say, you wouldn't believe it. On the radio came this song, and it just so spoke to me, and I realized, God, you did that. Yes, he did. No, that couldn't work that way. You say it's too complicated. It is such a healthy thing for the human heart when God gets so complicated you cannot figure it out. You can't come up with the explanation. This is it. I now have it all worked out. No, you don't. It's so healthy when God gets so big that your computer up here just says, it's too much data. I can't handle that. So here he goes. What a coincidence. And when Gideon had come, there was a man telling a dream to his companion. What a coincidence that he arrived at that very moment. Now you can believe that. It's much easier. God designed it. God was waiting. How do I think he did it? You know my stock answer. There were angels there. And they tapped a guy on the shoulder. Now, tell your dream. Now's the time to tell the dream. It doesn't work that way. Okay. I've had a dream. So Gideon's listening. Pura, his servant, is listening. And the other guy's listening. Now, this is just a side thought. How did he hear it? How did he understand what he was saying? These were Midianites. Well, I don't know. How did he understand the language? Well, that's a good question. To my surprise, a loaf of barley bread tumbled into the camp of Midian, and it came. So this is the guy having a dream. I saw a roll. Many of their bread are rolls. They're round. I saw this roll, round roll of barley bread rolling down the mountain. It rolled right into our camp and into the camp of Midian. It came to a tent and struck it. And it fell and overturned, and the tent collapsed. Some translations say the tent fell flat. And when that thing came down and hit the tent, it flattened the tent. That was my dream. It's interesting that Gideon, as I told you last week, means hewer, one that hews down. Because the interpretation is a fascinating interpretation. Then his companion, he had just come from dream interpretation class 101, and so he had the interpretation to that dream. And his companion answered and said, "This is nothing but the sword of Gideon, the son of Joash, a man of Israel, into his hand. God has delivered Midian, us, and the whole camp, all of us." That's quite an interpretation. Gideon, meanwhile, our man of the hour, he's there listening. And so God had that guy had that dream. This is the way it is. And so much of the time we live life, it's just me bumping along. And I don't look at life like God's hand is involved. And the more you look at life that way, the more you see it. And 2 weeks ago, I had someone tell me that they had a dream, and in this, they're not a part of this congregation. They had a dream, and in the dream, they saw this brilliant line of sparks that came from behind them, and they were looking east in the front lawn of their house, another city, another town in Tennessee, and that line just went whoosh, went over them. It was above them in the sky, and they saw it go in the direction, and they knew in the dream that it was Cleveland, Tennessee is where it went, and then they saw it come back, and they were afraid, but it was moving so quickly that they thought, I can't run or anything. But when it got back to them, it was rain, and they knew, oh my, is this good? It was yellow. The band was yellow. sparks. And in the past couple of days, they said, I had an interesting experience. Oh, really? Yeah. I was driving down. They live kind of on a plateau. If I say on top of a mountain, you think of a peak, and they're living up top, a shack up at the very top. It's kind of like the Cumberland Escarpment, the Cumberland Plateau, and you have to go up the face of the escarpment to get up to kind of where they live, up on the plateau. And they were coming down the plateau, and so this was real life. And they said, I was coming down the plateau, and I looked in front of me, and there was a Mayfield truck, a yellow Mayfield truck. And that's okay, but then I looked in my rearview mirror, and there was a yellow, and I can't remember the kind of car they said. There was a bright yellow truck right behind me. And all the way down the hill, which was it's not like our lane, Tolson Lane, it was a long hill. All the way down the hill, there in the middle, sandwiched in between these two yellow vehicles. And they thought one of the most wonderful biblical thoughts, the most biblical thought that you can deal with is responding to Jesus. And he said, who do you say that I am? That's the most pivotal thought for you to deal with in your whole lifetime. Who do you say that I am? Your Redeemer, Savior, you died for my sins. You rose from the dead. You are my answer to deal with what I cannot deal with. There's another thought that's a very biblical thought. It happened on the day of Pentecost when all this took place, and they were bewildered, and someone said in the King James, what meaneth this? Or in other words, a little more common, what in the world does this mean? Like it had meaning. And Peter answered it on the day of Pentecost. This means that God, Jesus, who you crucified, God has raised from the dead, and he's made him Lord and Christ. That's what this means. And they asked themselves, what does this mean? Yellow truck in front of me, a yellow truck behind me, you might say it means nothing. But if you'd had a dream 2 weeks before that where this brilliant yellow band goes over your head and then comes back and it's rain, you're at least alerted to the color yellow. When they happened to be around me, when they asked me, there's many in the congregation who have done the same thing, I would say, now, I'm not really the right one to ask because I'm going to assign God's involved in this. So I would say that was a wonderful dream that you had, and I know that you're an intercessor. They are. I know that you're an intercessor. My guess is God was just showing in response to your intercession that was what was being sent forth from you, and it's going to come back to you in your own life as rain. That's a wonderful dream. That's just wonderful. So when they told me, these two trucks, one in front of one, what did that mean? I said, I think God's given you in the natural. Because life is like a dream. And I mean by that, God speaks in dreams, God speaks in life. And you use the same rules to interpret dreams as you use to interpret life. So if you'd had a dream where there was a yellow truck in front of you and a yellow truck behind you and all the way down the hill, and you were right in the middle, you went all the way down the hill, I think you would interpret that as that was a confirming dream, that I was right in the middle of that yellow band, and because it came back on me and it was in the direction that I saw the thing go. I don't think that means anything. Okay, you can live life that way. Here was their response. This was one of the Midianites. This was one of the enemy. I'm telling you, that means Gideon, son of Joash. His sword, and God's given all of us into his hand. That's what it means. So Gideon is there hiding somehow, and he hears it. I think he goes, oh my goodness. Do I think he went through now how did this happen? I got here, and the moment I arrived, this guy starts telling a dream. And how come in the outpost, how come out of 135,000 people, the guy in the outpost at that moment is the one who had the dream? There's an easy answer. God. There's a complicated answer. Circumstance. Just really, you believe that? Kind of. I think that's foolish. What's much easier? God told him, you go down there and you're going to hear something. God's not that involved in life. Read the Bible. He is. So he's down there. Do I think he's going through all that analysis? I doubt it. I got here at this time period, and he says it, and that guy interprets it, and I'm here hiding out, and verse 15, and so it was when Gideon heard the telling of the dream and its interpretation that he worshiped. So you know what we do so many times? Wow, was I lucky. What an interesting thing that was. And we don't worship at all. We give the credit to nothing or luck. We give the credit to luck. And what Gideon did is he recognized God. This is you. And he worshiped. Do I think he yelled and danced and jumped up and down? Probably not. Wasn't a particularly good place to do that. But God knows the flow out of your heart. That's what's the important thing, is what's coming out of you. He returned to the camp of Israel and said, get out of bed, for the Lord has delivered the camp of the Midian into your hands. So he's coming out. What has he had? He's had a prophetic experience. God gave the leader a prophetic experience. To go back and say, do I think just even one of those 300s thought, how in the world are we going to pull this one off? He gave him a prophetic experience. Go down there. I want you to listen to a dream and the interpretation. And I want you to be so willing to put your life into my hands. Just take your armor bearer, Pura. It's a nice name, Pura. Why was his armor bearer's name Pura? That's a good question. Might there be a clue to what's going on behind the scenes if everything in the Bible has meaning, if every name has meaning, if every number has meaning, which I do believe, if everything has meaning, every color, every number, every city, the time periods, the people, if everything has meaning, well then maybe we'll learn something by Pura. Just what his name means. I have some observations on the story. Many of them I've done already. One, at Gideon's fear, God was addressing Gideon's fear. He was a man that fear was not completely conquered in. He was a man that started off with fear. God understood them. So God gave him an assignment to deal with his fear. Because in essence, as a leader, he had to lead the 300. So if in him there was still fear that had to be addressed, God had to work with him. God was working with those who were going to be with him, the 32,000 down to 300. God's saying, that's the right number. Because he wanted to make it difficult. No, he didn't want him to make the mistake of, we did this. Wow, aren't we good? He was addressing the leader's vulnerability, fear. So what did God have for him? A prophetic encounter that would enable him to rise above his fear. I want to suggest to you, I've seen God do this in my life so many times. If you'll look, you'll see this kind of interaction in your own life. Observation number two. It didn't make sense. God will offend the mind. There are times that he'll lead you. There are Bible stories, Naaman, this guy, an enemy, high-ranking officer of the enemy of Israel, has a servant girl who's a little Israeli girl, and she said, you know, back home there's a prophet. And he heals people. People get healed. And this guy had leprosy, and so a potential viable enemy of Israel sends a high-ranking officer and sends him to the king. You got some in your land that'll heal. I want you to heal my commander here. Of course, the king was reduced to terror. And he said, oh, I think there's a prophet. There's a prophet guy. He's the one. I could hear the king right now. I hope he's hot today. I'm telling you. I hope that hope that prophet's on it. So he goes, Naaman goes to the prophet, and the prophet just won't even go out and talk to him. He just sends his servant out, this high-ranking guy. Why? God's going to offend the mind so he can address the heart. He said, well, go down to the river and bathe 7 times. And at some point in time, he glances at the river, and it's dirty, and he thinks, we have so many better rivers, clean rivers back where I... He wants me to go down. He won't even come out and talk to me himself. He just sends his servant out to me. And he happened to have a servant with him that said, come on, you've come a long ways. And why not try it? Just try it. That's a good thing for you to do. Try it. What do I mean? God, I don't know about anything, that guy said, but if you're that involved in my life, open my eyes to it, I ask. It's a good thing to do. Seriously. I'm talking about genuinely out of your heart. That guy's even remotely, he's even 100% right about one point. Would you reveal that to me? It didn't make sense. So Naaman dips 7 times, the 7th time, the 6th time still leprosy, the 7th time he comes up out of this dirty water, and there he's clean. What was God going after? Humility. The guy's heart was full of pride, his position, his arrogance, his false gods, his clean water back home, all of those things. You mean God will really ask me to do something that just absolutely doesn't make any sense at all? Yes. Because he's trying to be mean? No, he's trying to address the blockages in your heart that hinder you and keep you from being available to receive what God has for you. You mean he's trying to help me get rid of things that are hindering me from living the kind of life he designed me to live? Absolutely. It didn't make sense. That's the point. God will offend the mind to reveal the heart. Seeing how God sees us, he understands what we deal with. He understands what he's called us to. He kind of sees us this way. I've raised you up to be a deliverer. Come on, that's who you are. Oh, I know you got this little hindrance on the inside of you. Let's deal with that. I have the plan for you. Take Pura, the two of you together. Go down there. You're going to hear something. It's going to change your life. What's a healthy biblical response when you have an encounter that you realize this is going to change my life? Start with worship. God, you did this. That's a great start. You did this. This is your hand. You set this up. You brought these people right at this point in time. This was you. Seeing how God sees us, God saw him as mighty man of valor. That's how God saw him. You strong man. No, I'm a fear-filled wimp. Oh, no, I see. Because that's how he made us. And he, the designer, the creator, made him. That's what he made him to be. This is what I have made for you to experience in life. And he knew when he was looking and focused on himself, I'm not that, I am this. Well, that's where you are right now, but I'm working with you because I'm bringing you from there to here. Because this is how I see you. This is what I've designed you for. And that's because why we have so much trouble so many times. Because we're not looking at ourselves. And here's the whole point. I'm going to be with you. That's how you're going to make it. Not because I'm going to make you to be the little train that could, because I'm driving this huge locomotive and I'm asking you to get on board and just go on a faith journey with me. You'll learn a lot about me. And I'll blow the horn every time that I want. And I'll tell you which car to ride in. That's what God does. The point, I will be with you. That's what the angel said to him at the very beginning of the encounter. How is this going to be? I will be with you. So, God, you want me to go through life having developed that for that to be, because you want to be with me. You want to walk with me in the garden. You want to spend time with me. You want a dialogue. You want relationship. Yes, that's what he wants. Number 5, Take Pura. I looked it up. Pura. What does that mean? It means branch. Well, that's great. Take Pura, the branch, with you. Now, the armor bearer, he was a servant armor bearer. They were for high-ranking individuals, and they would carry the shield, and they would carry sometimes additional weapons. And they would. It wasn't uncommon for them to go in front. It wasn't uncommon for them to give their life for the person they were the armor bearer for. They were a friend. They were a companion. They were accompanying. But it's interesting that his name means branch. I looked it up in many places. Branch. And eventually, branch. Do you think that that's referring to Jesus? That that's a hint? The righteous branch. Do you think it's possible that this story, that God was trying to speak to a so much bigger point that's lived out individually in our own lives? The bigger point meaning, I will be with you. If we're in Christ, he's inside of us. I'll be there. What you need is me. So you're saying to me, you're saying, you think the name of that guy, God picked that specifically, set it up. So when Gideon came and rose to the place, he picked Pura because he was going to use that as a teaching lesson for me and possibly for you. And whoever else knows the hundreds of thousands of millions of people through eons that have had the Bible. Yes, I do. Take Pura, branch, with you. Philippians 2:3. What is it that God's working on in our hearts? Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind. It's referring to Jesus. Think about others as higher, better than yourself. Verse 8, a little later on in that chapter 2, verse 8, he, Jesus, humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. I think fear and pride coming out of fear is ultimately the biggest thing we face. Even if you're anger-based, underneath that you'll find fear. Underneath fear, you'll find fear. I think pride is a cover-up for fear. It all comes down to fear, and there is only one remedy for fear. Ultimately, it's blood. Death. The blood of Jesus to cleanse us. He, Jesus, humbled himself. What is God looking for? For us to humble ourselves to him. So we grovel in the presence of God. So we remove the hindrance that is such a blockage. Option number 6. Divine appointments in time, location, timing. It's of God. Well, we go through life. What a coincidence. Just. Five or six weeks ago, I told you Faye was walking in Walmart, and she saw an Amish couple in Walmart up here, and we know no nearby Amish community, and she just had a desire to chat with them, in part because Faye's discovered that in her roots, in her father's line, is the first Amish man that we know of that moved from Switzerland to the United States. His name is Melchor Detweiler, and when a year ago when we were up in near Pennsylvania, we're in Pennsylvania, that home place, his original home place, is still preserved, and so we went to on her father's side. Her father's side came from the Detweiler line. And Faye enjoys those series that are Amish in series just because it's fascinating to learn about different cultures and how they live and act. And so she saw him and she just wanted to dialogue with him. They were attractive to her. They weren't a novelty of, ooh, you're a boy. I'm going to find out how you think, you know, or try and correct you. And their attention was taken by someone else, so she prayed the right kind of prayer. Her prayer was, God, if you want me to interact with these people, it's like thinking God's going to be at work in Walmart. I thought he was out there keeping the galaxies up in the air. He's actually going to be involved in where people are in Walmart, Knoxville, Tennessee, Clinton Highway. Pardon? And you prayed, God, if you want me to run into them, let me run into them again. And 10, 15 minutes later, she did. She turned a corner, they turned a corner. That's not the time to say, what a coincidence. Can you believe it? So they dialogued a little bit, and in the midst of the dialogue, Faye said, you know, been to Pennsylvania, you know, a number of months ago, and our family, my dad's line, blah, 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 come from the Detweilers. And so I have Amish roots. I don't know all the vocabulary Faye used in that conversation. And in a few minutes, the husband says, well, my wife was a Detweiler before I married her. Now, when that happens, you know the dots crossed. God's doing something. So through a series of events, Friday night, Faye and I went down to Sunbright, Tennessee, and went into their home and took them out to eat and spent 3 or 4 hours with them and went back in their home. And they said they're old order Amish. And old order, it wasn't legal. As much as we understand old order Amish, they can't do that. But they did. Why? Because God's doing something. Divine appointments. That, for Gideon, was a divine appointment. Out of 135,000 men, God led him to the guy who had the dream. Language miracle. I've mentioned that. How did he understand it? I think what happened is God gave him understanding, just like the woman that spoke. Remember Romans 12:12. The Ukrainian guy said she said it in Russian. Our group said no, she said it in English. I think he heard it in Hebrew. Do I think the Midianite was speaking Hebrew? No, I don't think he was speaking Hebrew. I think Gideon heard it in Hebrew. The language miracle. It was encouragement to others. Because he was going to go back up to the other 298 guys. We got this. Now, I think he probably said, the Lord has shown me, I'm telling you. We are in the place that we should be. And I'm not at the time that I should be. Oh my goodness. I'm trying to get this to advance. Oh, Psalms 103. One of the Psalms that I've stuck on, that's just really stayed in my craw, is those that... It's gone one too many. Can you back up one, please? Just one slide. Psalm 107, verse 23. Those that go down to the sea in ships, who do business on great waters. I've interpreted that, and God's interpreted to me. If you leave the shoreline and you're willing to walk on water, or you're willing to go way out into the deep following after me, in essence, if you're willing to go to the sea, some of the translations will say great ships. If you're willing to go out in the great ships, if you're willing to follow the Lord, if you're willing to walk on water, so to speak, where you're way over your head and it's only the Lord that's supporting you, there will be something that will happen. That do business in great waters, those that go down to the sea in ships, who do business in great deep water, who are way out over their head. They see the works of the Lord and his wonders in the deep. You go out to the sea in great ships, you have the opportunity to see what God's doing out in that part the wonders of God. I interpret that God invited Gideon, come down here into the deep. I want to show you something. And he did. That was way over his head. I want to show you something. Because I want it to evoke something in you that we would call worship. I want you to worship. Because I'm for you. I want you to have this experience where you're standing there blowing the trumpet and waving that torch, and they all turn on themselves. And you have, at a minimum, the chance to say, I was there. On that day, I was there. I had the privilege of being there. I couldn't believe how God did that. But he let me, I had a front row seat. Gloria Gaynor gave this prophecy in conclusion. Gloria Gaynor gave this prophecy, NCF, September 1990. I am going to flood back into your lives rivers of love, rivers of anointing, rivers of power, and yay, went on just a little bit more. You will even enter into a river of my rest, says God, and you will float along the river, and the river will do the rest of the thing I've called you to do, for I am bringing you into a place of my spirit. God intended from the very beginning for this to be a place where we exalt the workings of God through the Holy Spirit. And that's how he intends to accomplish it, through the Spirit. That he said, as you do, and in this paragraph, it was as you touch every nation of the world, as you flood into nations, as you let what I've given you flow through you, in of you, out of you, and touch the nations. And I'm even saying it's going to touch every single nation of the world. As you do that, I'm going to flood back into your lives. Rivers of anointing, rivers of power. Because that's how it's going to take place, not our strength or our numbers or our knowledge. And it's really being led by the Spirit is what I have called for you. You're just to float along in my Spirit. It's going to do the work. The Spirit, the Holy Spirit's going to do the work. And you're to come to a place of trust where you're just floating along, having a good day. Wonder what the Spirit's going to do today. I'm on the surface of the water in my inner tube. I'm just enjoying myself. Wow, look at what's going on. And I have a front row seat. I'm right there in the river. Pastor Mike Sexton. November 6th, and November 6th was a very interesting day. It was a Sunday. This was last year, 2016. Downstairs was a 4.5-hour pastoral staff meeting when a lot of things broke apart. When there was a lot, we realized how far apart we were, how much difference that we had. We just didn't see things the same. Meanwhile, upstairs, there was a citywide prayer gathering going on. And I was supposed to be a part of that. And it was clear to me downstairs, the meeting downstairs, I had to stay. So in the meeting upstairs, there's a pastor that we impacted years ago, actually during renewal, 95, 96, who was very heavily impacted. And he came into the building to be a part of that prayer meeting. He said he walked into the room and he walked into a prophetic, he walked into the presence of God. He walked into it. So downstairs, we were having an interesting, let's say, debate. Upstairs, God had a fellow pastor come into the sanctuary and walk into a presence. And he heard God say, I have a message for this church. I want you to deliver it. So he came to the front where there was a citywide prayer meeting going on. And he started to say to Dennis Sharp, who was leading the prayer meeting, I was kind of supposed to, but I was downstairs. I never made it upstairs. So here we are at a place where we're kind of downstairs, probably right over my office, where we're having an interesting discussion where we probably didn't agree with much with each other. And upstairs, God's giving a pastor, a fellow pastor in town, a message for this congregation. What a strange time. I didn't really find out about it till not this Friday, 2 days ago, a week ago. So all of December went by, all of January went by, and nearly all of February went by. I never really heard the story. I heard there was somebody who thought like God gave them something and they walked around the property. I found out that was not true. It was a good-hearted intended, but it's not what happened. And so not this Friday, Friday a week ago, I finally found out the story and heard, well, I want to talk to that guy. So I call him, and almost the phone call starts, almost it starts like this. I can't believe you're calling me right now. That happened back in November. I cannot believe you're calling me right now. Do you know where I am? No. I think you're in South Knoxville. That's where your church is. I don't have a clue where you are. I'm in Raleigh, North Carolina. Good. That's good country. Pretty. Okay. You're in Raleigh, North Carolina. I'm attending a conference right now. And what the conference is all about is what God spoke to me back in November 6th when I walked in your room when he said, I am going to do this again. And you're to tell him, I'm going to do this again. He said, I can't believe you've waited all this time. And now this is where I am. And I'm saying, I can't believe it either, but I've learned. It's the way God does things. So next Sunday night, 6 o'clock, he is coming with his intercessors. Dennis Sharp is trying his best to bring as much of the worship team that was here back in November the 6th. I'm inviting you to come. I really think if you're a part of this congregation, you really need to come. If you tell me, I can only go to one service on Sunday, my life is so, don't come next Sunday morning. Come Sunday night. If you say, I can only do one, I just can't. Come Sunday night. And I'm encouraging, this was part of it. I came into the building and into the sanctuary. I can't go through that. I want to advance to the slide where I talk about the fast. That's what I'm looking for. And so if you can keep just going through it up in this video booth until you find it. Got it. You did. Thank you. So preparing to welcome the river again. I would lead us and to prepare us to welcome the river again. The river of what? The anointing. What's it going to look like? I don't know. Is it going to be exactly like it was before? I doubt it. It might be, but I doubt it. Because I think it's for different purposes. But that's the Lord's business. But preparing our heart to receive what God's pouring out, I'm asking you to join me. I'm asking everyone in this congregation, everyone, I'm asking you to fast, a three-day fast, this week, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. I'm asking you, I know a few of you in here are on very select diets, gluten-free diets. I'll address that in a moment. I'm asking you to fast, you know, man shall not live by bread alone, by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. We have the written word. We have his speaking word where he's still talking today. Man shall not live by bread alone. So this is an every word fast. I want to hear every word, what he has spoken, what has been written down, what he is speaking now. And every word, man shall not live by bread alone, because scripture makes that connection. I've never done this before. I've never asked this before. I'm asking you to do, if it's got flour in it, fast it. So is this a sacrifice to the Lord? I heard someone make an excellent suggestion. No, let it be an offering. Just as Gideon, when that angel told him all the things, and he said, well, I want to go prepare something. And he prepared a kid and some bread and so on. He put it on a rock. And he said, this is my offering. The angel touched it, and the rock burst into flame, and it was gone. It was an offering. I'm encouraging you to, instead of looking at this as a fast or a starve, look at it as an offering. I'm giving the Lord an offering. I understand I don't live by bread alone. So for these 3 days, all day Friday, all day Saturday, all day Sunday till after the meeting, if it has flour in it, if it's in any way, shape, or form bread, so if it's bread or toast or English muffins or rolls or donuts or cake or pie or pasta or anything that's got flour in it, I'm going to give that as an offering to the Lord, because I want not to live by these things, but I want that what I live by is every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. So if you are in a situation where medically or because of your whatever reason, you don't eat gluten, so you don't eat flour-based anything, then pick something that's a part of your diet that you view as essential. This is essential in my diet, the one I'm working with. So this is the foundation. This is the important thing. You know, I just won't do. I won't eat candy bars. If you're not eating flour, you're not eating candy bars, or you're not being consistent. So 3 days, starting Friday morning, I'll send a thing out. I'm asking you to fast 3 days. For what purpose? Man shall not to prepare our hearts to give an offering to the Lord, to give a bread offering, or a suitable counterpart if bread is not a part of your diet at all. Pies and donuts and none of those things, or pasta, or none of that is a part of your diet, then something comparable. I'm asking everybody to do it. I'm asking everybody to come Sunday night. Even if it means, I can't come Sunday morning then. Don't. Please don't. I want us to welcome together what God's doing. What's going to take place? I don't know. Come and see. But I would that we would come with our hearts set on the Lord. Pura means branch. I believe that God pictured that the branch, the righteous branch, Jesus Christ, he'll go with you. You can go down to the Midianites all by yourself. I came to realize as I've pondered that thought that, you know, I think all through life, you know why God gives you real good friends? Yes, because of the relationship, fellowship, but in that friendship, I think what he's really trying to do is to get your eyes, appreciation of that friend, but past that friend, because God really wants to be with me. He's the one that wants fellowship, relationship. I think he fully intends for that relationship to be as fulfilling as it could be, but I think his intentions are actually far larger than that. Because underneath everything is he desires your relationship with him. It's available again through Jesus Christ. But for you to fellowship with him, walk with him, dialogue with him, listen to him, get his advice, choose the path that he has for you. I think marriage is intended to do the same thing. Yes, to be so fulfilling. Marriage is a great idea. Faye and I have been happily married. I've been happily married. I don't know if Faye's been happily married for 49 years. I have been. But the intention of that is God's, there's a bigger picture that God's addressing and speaking to. His intention, God Almighty, the account, I want to be with you. That's why I've created you. Not to be the big bad guy in the sky, because I want to be with you. I want you with me. I want you to dialogue with me. I want to dialogue with you in Christ through the Holy Spirit, the Father, the Trinity. So God will give us friends to take journey with us, and they can help us spiritually tremendously. The point is that's where it's supposed to stop? No. That's supposed to be just a bridge that we realize, God, you've done that. You've brought this friend in my life, and they are phenomenal. But the point behind the point is you. That experience that Gideon had, I'm sure he added to the treasures of his lifetime. I think he should have. But if the treasure stopped, let me tell you about the day when I was there, stopped with just the facts. It was sorely short of what was really happening at that moment. God did that. It was to help adjust his heart. Take Pura. If you're afraid, take Pura. Go down there. So I'm asking you, I'm asking you to begin a 3-day fast. A fast of bread, and I mean by that anything and everything that has flour in it, as an offering to the Lord. I'm giving this to you. Or something comparable. And I'm asking you to. This is not the week to watch. It's never the week to watch raunchy stuff on television. It's never the week to read raunchy stuff. It's never the time for that. This week is a good example. It's not the time to fill yourself with everything the world wants to offer you and say, this is really good for you. Just think how much you'll know. How much knowledge you'll be filled with. Give it to the Lord. My heart. Let me pray. Father, thank you for this day. It was way too long. I ask that you would grant grace to this congregation to yet again forgive me. You will prepare our hearts, Lord, for what you want to do and what you want to do through us. I ask that you would grant us the grace for this to be an offering. We welcome you. In Jesus' name, amen.